Anyone ever tell you you're incredibly annoying?
Anyone ever tell you you're from Monk's Corner? Because I could literally smell the beef jerky and deer urine when you walked in the room.
See, that's exactly what I'm talking about.
Let me guess. I should be a little more positive. What's up, bro? You want to go grab some taquitos after racquetball today?
No.
FYI, for your information and what have you, a positive attitude has never solved one problem. But it can make a lot of people hate you. I mean, no one can stand those people with their lemonade for life perspectives. Like that girl you work with, the one that always acts like she ate rainbows for breakfast and rode a unicorn to work. Yeah, she's a lot of fun to hang out with. There's a reason she has a picture of her cat for her home screen.
All right, since you know everything, then what advice would you give to somebody who's struggling with negative thoughts?
I would say, learn to laugh at your problems, because everyone else is laughing at you, I mean.
That's a terrible thing to say to someone.
Hey, I don't make the rules, I just make the exceptions. Kind of like your haircut. But let's be honest, everything's so much funnier as long as it's not happening to you. Am I right? Have you ever gone on YouTube? Pull out your phone, look up, guy on a Segway gets hit by a falcon. I mean, look it up, it'll be the first thing pops up.
Bam, wow. I'm really regretting we set up these interviews.
Are you kidding me? I'm at the top of a very short list of good things that have ever happened to you. Anywho. Taquitos! You see what I did there? I brought it back around, because that's how I work. Break it back. I'm good. Feeling good about that.
Everything changed for me when I realized that you don't have to feel forgiven to be forgiven. And many of us wait for the feeling of forgiveness to come before we move forward in what God has called us to. The problem with that is the moment that you feel forgiven for something in your past, you're going to do something else in the meantime that is going to become your past in the future, which will soon be your present. And you'll be right back at it again. So if you play that game, the chatterbox will just trip you all day long, shut you down. I tell a story in the book, and it was the hardest story to write, but it ended up being my favorite part of the book, about how one Christmas, Holly decided to be a very helpful wife and take all the trash out because I was so tired from preaching all the different Christmas worship experiences at our church. And what she didn't take into account was the weather and the fact that the trash didn't come for 4 days. So by the time I went and saw all the trash stacked up, these boxes had flown all over the yard. It was the most chaotic scene. And in the book I talk about, one of the boxes in particular was full of all these packing peanuts. And so, you know, it became what I call the Christmas apocalypse. And after 30 minutes or an hour of trying to clean all this up and the wind is blowing everything around, I realize I'm not cleaning this up. This isn't gonna happen. And in the middle of that, I lost my temper. I ended up saying some things that aren't very preacher-like or very Christ-like. And not to her because she was gone, but in front of our middle child, Graham, and how embarrassed I was. But the packing peanuts to me became an analogy for like how thoughts of condemnation just start to fly all around in your mind to the point where you can't even stop them. By the time you start entertaining those thoughts, it's one thing, then another, then another, then another. And like you're trying to grab at all of these things and they're just flying everywhere. Once you open the box, then, you know, it's gonna be so overwhelming. You know, once you start entertaining the thoughts of you're not worthy, it's going to be impossible for you to grab all of that because it's just everywhere. I don't know if you've ever made a mistake and the way that the mistake affected you because of the way that it stayed with you caused way more damage than the original mistake did. So the enemy is very intelligent. And before you sin, he'll tell you, go ahead and do it. It doesn't matter. It's no big deal. Then after you sin and you open that box up, he'll tell you, it's so bad what you just did, God doesn't even want to talk to you. And isn't it interesting how the moments where we need God's presence the most, we feel like we can come to him the least. You know, it's in those moments when I am feeling tempted, when I am feeling dirty, when I am feeling ashamed, that I most need for God to touch me, that I most need for God to heal me, that I most need to be able to cry out to him and call out to him. But Satan is so smart that he's found a way to get us to believe that we're not worthy to come to God in those times after our failure. We're not worthy to come to God in those times after we gave into the thing for the 15th time, for the 15,000th time. Yet I realized that I wasn't worthy to come to God on my best day. I wasn't worthy to come to God on my cleanest day. So it's finding a different foundation for approaching God. One thing I like to think about when it comes to dealing with condemnation and thoughts of condemnation is that I'm going to beat the enemy at his own game. In other words, when I sin and when he tempts me into sin and starts to exaggerate the effects of that sin and tell me that I can never come before God now, I'm going to just run that much faster into the presence of God. So if every time the enemy reminds you of your past, you come running into the presence of God, it won't be long before he'll stop reminding you of your past because it's actually working to his disadvantage. You have to learn how to find a way, even after you've sinned, to come to God and say, I don't like myself very much right now. I'm just going to be honest with you. I'm sick of myself. I don't feel like I have the right to talk to you right now. But on the basis of what Jesus has done for me, I believe there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And even though I don't feel forgiven, I am forgiven. I'm forgiven based on what you have done. And before long, you're going to find yourself being changed, because condemnation can never change you. It can only paralyze you and keep you from the presence of God. God does not change us through condemnation. He changes us through conviction. And conviction is very different than condemnation. As I point out in the book, condemnation is a counterfeit form of conviction. The Holy Spirit will convict you. He'll say, this is what I'd like to change in your life. This is how I want to work in you to make you more like Christ today. This is something I want you to get rid of because it's holding you back. That's conviction. It's very specific. It's spoken in a loving way, and it's based out of the potential that God sees in you. Condemnation is very different. It's generalized. As I say in the book, there are three P's of condemnation. It's always permanent, it's always personalized, and it's always pervasive. It means that condemnation will get you to say, not only were you like this in that situation, you're always going to be like that. You always have been like that. Your mom was like that. Your mom's mom was like that. There's no hope for change. It's permanent. Personalized. Doesn't tell you that you've sinned. Tells you that you are a shameful, dirty, rotten sinner. Makes it all about who you are, not just what you did. Of course we need to be convicted for things we do wrong. Of course we need to learn from our mistakes. Of course we need those times when God puts his finger on an area of our lives and says, this is something that I want to redeem and turn into something better. There's a better way I have for you to live. Guilt can be something that can lead you to repentance. I shouldn't have done that. I don't want to do that again. I'm going to build my life in a different way so that I don't keep doing that. That's guilt. And if you take it to the right place, God can use it. Shame is the enemy's weapon to try to get you to associate who you are with what you did, to define you with a label because of something that you did. And that's never from God. And it's also pervasive, meaning that not only do you now feel like one area of your life is out of whack, everything's out of whack. The packing peanuts are flying everywhere. You know, I'm standing out there in the yard and I'm picking up packing peanuts. And it's like the end of the world to me. And it's just this little small thing. And then I lose my temper. Then I feel like a bad dad and a bad husband. And Holly's probably going to leave me. I'm going to be a drunk. And next Christmas, I'm going to be in the gutter strung out on heroin. It just goes everywhere. And you have to stop and take that box. And when it comes to you and it starts flying all around, you got to take your thoughts of condemnation that you're feeling and write return to sender. back on the box and say, this thought did not come from God. This shame does not come from God. This condemnation does not come from God. And I'm going to send it back to the pit of hell where it came from. I'm not going to allow all of this to fly around in my life and get me off track. I'm coming back to what Christ has done. God says he has forgiven me. So whether or not I feel forgiven, I am forgiven. And by faith, that forgiveness is going to change me into a new person each and every day. I think a lot of people would agree God can use someone who used to struggle with sin. God can use someone who has sin in their past. But the question becomes, can God use me when I struggled with sin last night, when I struggled with sin 13 minutes ago? Can God use somebody like me who constantly struggles with sin? And of course, I believe the answer is yes, because if God only used perfect people, there would be no Crash the Chatterbox book. There would be no ministry for me. But to take that to a deeper level, I believe that often the thing that we want to hide is the thing that God wants to use the most. And I'm convinced of that because when Paul, who was the greatest apostle that we have on record, the greatest man of God who ever put pen to paper, obviously you could argue Abraham, Moses, and all of those. Jesus is in a class all by himself. But Paul stands out to me because he was someone who had every credential, every right to flash his badge of, here's why I'm important, here's why I'm a great apostle, here's my pedigree, here's the seminaries that I've been to. Yet in 2 Corinthians 11, one time, Paul is defending himself to the Corinthian church against a group known as the super apostles. So this group thought they were not only apostles, they were super apostles. Like these are generals in the army of the Lord. And Paul wants to defend his authority as an apostle. Like, hey, God called me, God chose me. But he does something so interesting and something that's almost bizarre. He starts boasting about his weakness in order to prove his calling, in order to prove God's power in his life. So he talks about trials he's been through, how he's been in prison, how he's been flogged, how he was beaten with rods, pelted with stones, shipwrecked, all of these things that would seem to indicate that God had abandoned Paul, but he uses it as proof of God's presence and power within him. But at the end of that little section in 2 Corinthians chapter 11, he says, who is weak and I do not feel weak? Who is led into sin and I do not inwardly burn? And I find that so interesting because, you know, this chapter is almost like Paul showing his scars in ministry. He's showing all the times where he was beat up, all the times where he was neglected, all the times where he was persecuted. And he's showing all those scars that you can see, but then he says, there's some other scars that I have that you can't see. He's saying that there are some weaknesses that I've endured, but there are some also some weaknesses that I carry within me, some internal scars. But yet there's something that Paul knew that changes our lives when we realize it, is that God not only allows our scars and knows our weaknesses, but if offered to him, he will show his strength in those very scars, in those very weaknesses. It's interesting to me how, as a preacher, I can go on and on and on and on, all of these stories and all of these Bible applications, and people forget all about that. But if I share a story about how one time I was in Target and I beat the snot out of my kid because they were acting like a demon in the candy aisle, people will come up to me years after and say, I remember that story about when you beat your kid that time. Because it shows them that God not only can use someone who struggles with sin, but God specializes in using people who struggle, because the weaker I am, the stronger he can be. Now, this isn't a license for us to sin. Well, if God uses sinful people, I'll just go out and live like hell. I'll just really give God something to use. I'm going to Vegas tonight. I want to give God plenty of raw material. That's not what we're saying. Of course we want to improve. Of course we want to be more like Christ. Of course we want to set a good example. But when we honestly and openly show our scars to others and say, hey, I struggle with my temper. Hey, I struggle with depression. Hey, I struggled with an eating disorder. Hey, I struggled with that addiction. It gives people hope to know that the people that God uses are not the people who hide their weakness, but that offer their weakness to God in a way that it can become his strength. Recently, our son Grim had to go get stitches because he had busted his knee wide open. And when the doctor was stitching him up, he looked at me and he was so proud. He said, "Daddy, my scar has a shape." And he actually showed me, because his leg was still gashed open, it was halfway stitched up, but where the scar on his knee was shaped like the logo of our church. The logo of our church, Elevation Church, is like this upward pointing arrow, which represents the resurrection. And Graham's knee had been busted open, but it was shaped exactly like the logo of our church. And he was so proud, "Daddy, my scar has a shape." And I realized in that moment, looking at Graham and his little silly scar on his knee, that God shapes all of our scars. If we let him, he'll take things that we've been through, things we struggle with, things that we haven't conquered yet, things that we hurt from, all these things that the enemy would use to indicate that we're useless to God. And God will shape it in such a way to say, "I will show my strength in your weakness. But I can't do it if you hide it. You've got to be willing to come to me and show your scars. You've got to be willing to show the scars that you have to the world and say, 'I'm not perfect, but I'm being perfected.'" And the quickest way that you can disrupt God's perfecting process in your life is to try to present an image of yourself that is perfect to others. You got to be willing to say, "I still struggle." And when God sees someone who's willing to say, "I struggle," that's someone that he can show himself strong in.